That's a good omen, having babies crying at the beginning of a curse lecture. I'm Clifford Hartleigh. I have lectured here on curses many times over the years, but not very recently. But this year's theme of wrath sort of made me feel as though it's probably a good time for me to bring out the old curse kit and teach you some new things and refresh you on some old things. I'm the guy who coined the term dark paganism and dark pagan back in the early days of the internet, around maybe 1994. And I used this to describe myself and people that I felt might be out there who identified as pagan or Wiccan but didn't really believe in the threefold law or the Wiccan reed. And when I reached out in the early days of the internet, I didn't find anybody else like me, but those numbers have grown to an enormous mob nowadays. And people, regardless of whether you consider yourself a pagan in one sense or another, are becoming very interested in curses of all kinds today. The stigma that's associated with curses has begun to fade away, especially because of the politics that we have today with everybody trying to bind Donald Trump, or the opposite. I usually describe dark pagans as people who are members of goddess religions or earth-centered religions or polytheistic religions who are okay with curses, at least some of the time. Originally, I thought of myself as a great practitioner because I wasn't doing curses all of the time, but that was kind of a wussy thing. I ended up identifying fully as a dark pagan. Back in the 90s, I became obsessed with the idea of creating the perfect curse. And during the same period where I was trying to kind of come up with terms to describe myself, I thought it would be a really useful experiment to do a curse about, you know, once every week. I had a weird idea of balance where I would be doing a blessing a week and a curse a week, and I ended up doing over 1,000 curses as a result. So if you believe that karmic backlash is going to kill you, the threefold law is going to womp on you, I should be dead several hundred times over by now, so it's a superstition, it's not real. I'm proof of concept that you can do all the curses you want and end up with a relatively happy life. That doesn't mean that curses are safe. You can handle them poorly. You can get backlash. You can curse yourself in the process of cursing others. Curses are weapons. They're metaphysical weapons. My attitude towards curses are very similar to some of my friends who are gun nuts towards gun safety. This is not something to be done around children. This is something that you practice, you get good at, and you study very thoroughly so you make sure that not only you don't get hurt, but the correct target is hit. Another thing that I tend to use as a metaphor when it comes to curse work is I see it as analogous to Asian martial arts in the sense that it's a spiritual technique which addresses the negative qualities of the world that we live in, and in the process of engaging with it, we elevate ourselves to a higher spiritual level. I believe that we have to address curse work to some degree philosophically. In my past lectures, I've been kind of heavy on the why you should do curses or why not you should do curses. I've felt that everyone has got their own reasons for why you would potentially engage in curse work. But I think people are more interested in techniques than the whys and wherefores and why nots. But I do want to address it a little bit, and I think that life is harsh, and sometimes to survive you have to be as harsh as life. Life is going to bite you. It's time you learn to fight back. Curses are supposed to be scary for a lot of reasons. They are dangerous, but also the emotions that you engage with in destructive magic is often fuel or an enhancement or a means of focus to improve the quality of your curses and make sure they get to the targets and do them the kind of harm that you desire and the right targets. When you're preparing for your curses, that's the time for you to address the ethical issues. Many people do justified magical work, by which means you consult tarot or divinatory systems, you consult your gods and spirits, whether this is the right choice for you. Because once you cross the line, once you decide that you're going to do the curse, you should hold nothing back. You have to be a total rat bastard in order for the spell to be effective. So there's multiple phases of the operation. There's the planning and then the execution. And in the execution, be as mean as you possibly can be. That's the only way to make a curse work effectively. If you basically pull punches, it's like trying to slow down a bullet. It won't go as far and it won't go as deep. My opinion about aesthetics has changed quite a bit radically since the 90s. I used to believe that the aesthetics that you put into your curse workings, whether it's, you know, colorful candles or robes or daggers, is a good way of psyching yourself up to get into the right mental state. But I've come around to a different perspective in that aesthetics are sometimes an impediment to effective curse works. I believe that if you try to rack up style points, that will deduct from the hit point damage you're doing to your enemies. You should be efficient, you should be destructive, and you should be ruthless. And sometimes that may mean dressing up in an outfit that you think looks ridiculous, or doing things that seem childish or strange to you. But the only thing that really matters is results. The only thing that matters is the amount of power being dumped into the system and propelling your spell to an effective conclusion. There's a division between the types of curses that you do towards mundanes or muggles and the types of spell work that you do towards fellow practitioners who are fighting with you. And also to spirits, because you can do a curse on a disembodied spirit the same way you could do it towards an enemy practitioner. Cursing a muggle, cursing a mundane is relatively easy because while they do have some defenses from their ancestral spirits they may not even be aware of, cursing a antagonist, a magical antagonist, is much harder because they will have defenses. And part of the process of being a competent practitioner of curses is always changing things up so you can knock through the defenses of your enemy. Most of the time that you're doing curse work and you are engaging with an antagonistic practitioner, they're probably not really competent. There are very few people who are very, very competent in curses. If you are proficient in your curse work and you change things up, it will help circumvent their defenses and knock them down better. One of the most effective things that you can do when you're attacking a magically proficient opponent or someone who's somewhat proficient is to basically tenderize them a little bit, knock down their defenses so it's easier and for you to get your bullet through and to do as much damage as possible. Let me read off of this. There's an endless arms race of attack and defense now, but constrained only by the limits of power and your ingenuity. It's always be good to change up your techniques, as I said before. Okay. It's important to know where your power comes from in spell work. If you don't know where the power comes from, it's probably coming from you. There are multiple sources of power when you're doing magic. There's a spark of the divine in everyone, and that's usually the source of all power that you devote in your magic when you're not invoking an external source. And when you are invoking external sources, whether it's gods, planetary spirits, demons, ghosts, and so forth, and stranger things, each of them will have different limitations based upon the realms from which they originate and the basic nature of the entity. But you have your own limitations, and one of those limitations is that you have a finite amount of personal power. No matter how powerful you are as a personal magician, witch, or sorcerer, you've got a battery within you. If you're like me, you do a lot of energy work so that you have the largest battery possible, but it's also inevitable that you deplete that power source at some point. Sometimes when I do really impressive and complex magical work, I will feel exhilarated afterwards, and then I will go to bed and expect to sleep 20 hours. That's because my battery's been completely freaking drained. One way to get around that, of course, is to use power sources other than you, whether that's from the gemstones, herbs, spirits of nature, ghosts, planetary spirits, and gods of exalted gods and infernal and negative gods are also sources of power who you can invoke, and angels, of course, as well, to propel your spell to a successful conclusion. Each of these types of entities will have different traits and different limitations. So that, for example, if you're trying to do a curse by way of an ancestral spirit or a ghost, they're dead people and they are full of the essence of death. And that will have very specific traits when you're putting curses upon an enemy. It will cause them to decay, it will cause them to become tired, it will cause them to be depleted. You can use ghosts to engage in malevolent poltergeist-like activity, and that will work differently than basically invoking a demon to some extent or an angel or a god. They will all do different types of manifestations. They all have their own bizarre quirks. And of course, the gods are the most powerful of all, but of course, they're the least likely to intercede on your behalf in a curse working. But of course, it's great when it does. It's great when they do. All right, I want to talk about some general strategies. First, do you have any questions before I go on? and see where we're at. Oh, 13 minutes. 13 minutes in. What a fortunate number. We have babies crying. We've got 13 minutes in. Seems very appropriate for the day. All right. The first thing I try to teach people nowadays is he who tells destroys spells. This is a general principle. When you do magic secretly, whether it's curses or non or benevolent magic, it has a tendency to have more power. Secrecy is a source of power in and of itself. My own experience is that over the years, when I've told people that I was doing a spell that they were not involved with, it tended to work less well or not work at all. My most powerful spells of all are the ones that I kept the secret of what I was doing for the longest period of time. It built up power. Another strategy that I recommend to people is to start with simple ingredients and then step up when if you don't feel satisfied with the results. Now, this is a very positive example rather than a curse spell, but one of the things I do for friends and clients is I take a single white candle, small one, and I anoint it with Van oil, and I engrave the person's name on it, and I light it in front of my altar, which is one of my altars, which has a lot of, you know, powerful talismans and objects on it, but it's really not a lot of work, and it basically knocks down obstacles in that person's life enormously. Why do a more complicated spell, which may turn out to be less effective, when you do something inexpensive and simple at the start? And the same is true with curses. Some of my most powerful curses involved dressing a black chime candle like this one, burning on an altar, and basically destroyed the person that it was targeted at. It's efficient for you to step up and start small and then go towards complex. Even if you're doing an elaborate spell, do an elaborate spell as a one-shot, and if only if that fails, then you go towards maybe 13-day spells, and if that doesn't bring you satisfaction, then you do for an indefinite work, like, for example, creating a puppet, which you make in the name of your enemy, and you torment it over an indefinite period of time until, you know, you decide that they've had enough or they die. Let's see. Curses should always be done confidently, even if you scare yourself a bit. Fear is an important part of your curse work, but you need to compensate for that and push forward and basically, you know, intimidate the universe into submission when you do your curses. Spirits do not respect cowards, and you have to engage with a persona of mastery, a mindset of mastery when you are in the ritual chamber, when you are doing your spell work, or the spell work will tend to fail. There's a division that I noticed over the years, which does not appear to be documented anywhere, and that is there are, while many people do both, there are often people who whose curses are fueled by a hot emotion or a cold emotion. And there are some people who are better at one than another. So for me, I'm better with hot emotions when I'm doing spell work. My rage fuels it. But I had a friend and colleague in the 90s named Jeff, and he was better with cold anger. His curses work best when he approached it with the kind of attitude of a surgeon where he slowly cuts out the heart of his enemy. It's important for you to find out if your curses work better with hot anger or cold anger, and to stick with that to some extent. There's no harm in you doing both, but of course you don't want to waste your energies, time, and money. Experiment. One may feel better than the other. That has no relationship with the results. The results are what matter. Another way to build up towards your curse working is to set up a specialized curse altar. I used to have two. Sometimes I've had one. The old notion of specialized spaces for curses actually involved you having a separate house back in the day when you could, you know, build a shed or something. People generally can't afford that, but some people, you know, can find an abandoned house or build a tent in the woods or find a clearing where they can do their curses, because the negative energy that you are expressing through your curse work can mess up your home. And one way to prevent that is to have a segregated spirit altar for negative workings, surround it with consecrated salt, and in the case, create a visual boundary between that and the rest of your spiritual work and the rest of your home. Ideally, it should be done outside the home. Not everybody can do that. I can't do that right now, so I have a specialized curse altar for all my negative stuff. On your curse altar, you should put the statues of the gods that you propitiate. to protect you from dangers, as well as the ones that you you have a relationship with, to perform curses upon your enemies. Also, your cursed spirits who you work with, spirits of the netherworld. Usually this altar is put towards the ground because the spirits of the netherworld are just more associated with negative actions. So I've changed up my cursed altar periodically, but I had a statue of Persephone on there, a statue of Boya on there, a statue of Hades on there at various points. I had an object, which I call the Hell Tree, which I talked about in my prior lectures, on there for a while, and stacks of cursed talismans, along with relics and personal concerns of my enemies. But I would always put offerings on my cursed altar, which represented darkness, death, and misery. So what I usually tended to do is I took eggplants, and this is an idea which I stole from Xanthari and Oya's offerings. Eggplants are black foods. And I cut it open, filled it with a cayenne pepper, put 13 pins into it. Sometimes I anointed the pins with some of the curse oils that you see behind me here. And that would be my weekly offering to the spirits of darkness, death, and suffering, ruin, and tragedy, in order to build up my relationship with them, so when I did do the curse, they were ready to roll. Another trick that I learned that was, I'm very impressed with myself. Basically, if you find out what gods and spirits that your enemy works with, make offerings to those gods, and you ask them, when my enemy is attacked by me, when I attack the enemy, abandon them. You bribe the gods of your enemies so that they will step aside and allow their deaths. That is extremely effective. I had an antagonist years ago who was a Hecate worshiper, so I spent years building up by making offerings to Hecate, and then I went on a full onslaught on him, and his defenses crumbled. There's numerology for cursing, but it's a bit contradictory. Some people use the malefic planets Saturn and Mars and the numbers associated with them by way of Agrippa, so that number 3 is associated with Saturn in Agrippa, and the number 5 is associated with Mars, and sometimes 15 is also associated with Saturn. These are the planets of destruction. Saturn is the planet of age and infirmity, and Mars is the planet of dismemberment, violence, and bleeding. But I find that there's another numerological system that I've come to favor, which apparently comes from Johannes Trithemius, who was actually Agrippa's teacher and mentor. And he associates the number 8 with Saturn. That's a malevolent number, and the number 9 with Mars. And I found those correspondences to be more effective in my magical phase. Another useful universal is things which are picked up voluntarily by your target, or something that they accept or takes, or even takes into their bodies, circumvent all the defenses of your antagonist. It's like the idea that if you invite a vampire into your home, it is you can't hurt it anymore. It has power over you. Similarly, if you take an object and you curse it and you send it to an enemy in the mail, they open it up and they touch it with their hands, the act of accepting a cursed object cuts through all defenses that they may have. The worst thing you can do to somebody is to give them a cursed object that they can consume, drink, or eat. Once they accept that into their body, all the defenses, even the defenses of energy which project from our skin, is eliminated, and basically they become thoroughly cursed from within. Curses work best when they violate boundaries, such as on the property of your antagonist, or consumed or placed on their door or threshold. Another really nasty thing to do is if you creep to your enemy's home and you put something, a cursed ingredient, a powder or an oil, across their threshold and they step over it or they step upon it, that energy travels up their legs and poisons them spiritually from within. Another thing that I wanted to, one of the principles is that if you violate boundaries, if you violate a person's personal space, that increases the charge or the power of the curse work that's being done. One of the more common things that you see in hoodoo is throwing herbs upon someone. If there's somebody walking away from you and you have some powder in your hand, you throw it upon them. The physical connection that is made from thrown herbs or iron filings or powders carries the energetic charge that you're projecting through your hand and entering their body, and also manifesting more physically, because it's a material connection as well as an energetic connection. Some of the most effective curses I've seen were actually done by accident, where people took positive magic and did it slightly wrong. There was a woman here several years back, a very nice person, who, without asking me, did Reiki on me and nearly burned down my house. She did it slightly wrong, and that was nearly deadly. There was someone else I knew in California who was doing an energetic healing of someone with cancer, and it actually just caused the person to die. A lot of people believe that your intentionality is enough to make sure that the magic is safe. That is contrary to my own experience, where I constantly see people botch benevolent magic and end up hurting the person that they want to help. This also provides a degree of guidance. Some of the tools that you use for healing and protection can be tweaked to be extremely deadly. The most effective curse talisman I ever made was an experimental benevolent talisman that I made slightly wrong. I made a number of talismans a little bit too close to an eclipse. I made another one because I thought it would, you know, bring me a kinky girlfriend. I made one with Venus and Zero Scorpio, and it nearly basically brought down the roof of my home and caused a great deal of mischief. That's one of the prices of being an experimental magician, is trying to push the envelope. You'll occasionally do things which blow up in your face. Unfortunately, I've got thick skin, so I survived those foolish experiments. But whenever you encounter something in your magic experience which is horrible, write that down. That's useful for later. Any kind of botched experiment, any kind of thing which just makes you wince, even things which, you know, happen in your environment where somebody has compound fractures, take notes of terrible things which happen to people and people, places, and things, and try to learn from those to replicate them against your enemies. Terrible things are things you can hoard in your knowledge and then deploy as weapons later on. Another type of spell that's interesting are bindings. Bindings are a concept which appears in many different traditions and many different implementations, and they are attempts to lock down intentionality or spirit in matter, lock it down so that it doesn't move, or lock it down so that it's unable to express itself. So some bindings are, for example, cords, which are given knots so that a person's nature is bound down or an idea is bound into reality. Not all bindings are negative, of course. They are sometimes attempts to root a spirit in a physical form so that it can obey you and do your bidding. But which, of course, this is a curse class, so we won't focus on the negative expressions of it. Freezer spells are types of bindings where basically you take something which represents your enemy, a personal concern, a photograph or so forth, and put it in a liquid and then put it in your freezer so that that person basically is unable to hurt you or unable to do something you don't want them to do. Another type of binding are woven numbers. You see kameot, a number of squares. This is a way of rooting spirit and matter, which is normally evanescent and can't exist in a single space for any extended period of time. This is a way of providing a body for a spirit. And in the context of curses, sometimes that can be a negative spirit, like a martial entity or Saturnine entity. All right. Any questions before we continue? All right.
So for any kind of curse work you've done, do you find that you specifically structure people or like places or buildings or things like that also?
You can curse almost anything. Isn't that wonderful? certain types of curses work better for particular types of targets. So one of the many systems of magic that I work in, and I should have mentioned that before, I've studied more systems of magic than anybody else I know. One of the ones I love the most is medieval and Renaissance astrological magic, which is sometimes called Arab astral magic in the Middle East, or called scholastic image magic in the medieval and Renaissance Christian Europe. It's mostly about evoking planetary spirits and the creation of astrological talismans. These gemstone rings that you see on every finger of mine, these are astrological talismans. This cane is an astrological talisman. They've been all engraved at astrologically propitious times to trap a type of spirit into the object, which then basically becomes like a familiar spirit and does favors for me. Or in a more passive way, allows me to enhance my personality, my health, and various other personal attributes. It's a way of basically creating a scaffolding or maybe a prosthetic limb for the imperfections of your natal chart at the same time, but also creates an army of servants for those who master this tradition. But in addition to benevolent spirits, which you can attach to yourself in order to magnify your positive traits, you can create the opposite of that. You can create astrological talismans which attract negativity and cause problems in its environment. And those are extremely dangerous, like the Venus in Zero Scorpio one I mentioned a little bit earlier, and the one that was too close to the eclipse, which is an Arcturus talisman. So what you do in that tradition is you take a bit of wax, or you take a gemstone or a plate of precious metal, and during an unfortunate time, and this is very complex calculations, you make particular engravings on that object, and then you place it under the home of your enemy, or at the city gates of a city that you want to afflict. They're actually curses which are purported to be able to bring down entire cities. And back in the ancient world, we're believed to, you know, a city meant a civilization back then. So theoretically, a properly created malevolent talisman can bring down an entire civilization. This is extremely advanced, this is extremely dangerous, and nobody really knows exactly how to do that anymore, but the old recipes are out there and they provide clues for the creation of these extraordinarily powerful, deadly talismans. And you could use an astrological talisman to curse an individual. You have to basically give them as a gift a cursed ring or a pendant or something along those lines. But usually these objects are relatively large, usually mineral spheres or plates of metal. And these are usually put in the proximity of those who you want to curse under their home. There are some recipes from this tradition which if you can't get to the home of your enemy, simply putting the talisman within the boundaries of the town that they live in is a way of cursing them, though in my experience when I've done spells like this, this takes a long time to work. There was one of these that I did, it was the fourth lunar mansion talisman, it was Aldebaran, and its purpose is to cause arguments and hatred between people, and I used this to break up a couple and took 2 years to do that because I didn't feel comfortable enough to bury the talisman close to their home. But I went to the same borough of New York where they were living, and I buried it there. And 2 years later, they broke up. Curses upon locations are definitely popular in hoodoo, but those curses tend to be a little bit more focused upon attacking an individual, partially because, you know, ethics, there may be other people living in the home or apartment building, and you want the negative energy to be directed towards the specific individual, not to be diffused, and also you don't want to deal with the moral consequences of hurting potentially innocents, so some people don't care about that. But still, if you want to focus the energy and do the maximum amount of destruction in hoodoo work, basically you want to have the material either on that person or get a material from that person to be charging on your curse altar spaces. Anything else?
What's your feeling on the use of blood in your curses?
I don't use my blood in curses, but if I'm able to obtain menstrual blood or blood from a target, what we call a personal concern or a relic, depending upon the tradition, that's a really good way to attack someone. The reason why I don't like using blood in my own rituals for positive or negative purposes is that the idea is that as my blood would congeal, it might sympathetically set up a resonance with me and make me sick. But since we're taking blood ideally from that of an enemy and we're charging that with negativity, the idea is that such as the blood on the altar is congealing and rotting, so will the enemy rot from within. So, yeah, blood is definitely something you totally can use in curses, and it's one of the best things you can do. There's a specialized vocabulary that's used in hoodoo for curses that you may or may not be familiar with. I'm going to run down a few of these off of the paper. To banish someone is to send them away. To bind them is to tie them down and make them unable to do certain things that you don't want them to do. There are spells which make someone confused in mind. They create a mental fog. It can cause mental illness, but more often it basically blocks a person from seeking remedies to curses. One of the most useful things you can do is you really want to lay the whammy on someone really hard is to add an ingredient of confusion in your curse spell work so that they don't realize they've been cursed. They just think they're naturally unlucky and they don't seek help. Or if they want to seek help, something obstructs them, binds them, prevents them from remedying. And that basically is a way of torturing a person for the rest of their lives.
Now, the confusion is a bind?
Yes. In hoodoo, this is mostly used with black poppy seeds and what other things are used for that? That's the one that comes to mind most immediately. Agar, sometimes used for invisibility, that can also be used to make your role in the curse invisible. Let's see. Crossings are negative conditions upon a victim, which are long-lasting. They don't naturally fade away. Other types of curses do naturally fade away. And that's why we have the term uncrossing, because when you have enduring negative conditions, bad luck, poor energy, mysterious health complaints, they won't naturally dissipate on their own. You have to use some kind of cure which undoes this kind of metaphysical poison which has entered you or your space. Curses are verbal. The evil eye is sometimes thought to be a curse. I don't think it's a curse. The evil eye, I believe, is an etheric deformity which some people are born with and are usually not even conscious they're using it. When they feel jealous towards someone, the person in their environment gets sick and gets sicker indefinitely. The cures and protections that are used against the evil eye are sometimes very different from those which are used for conventional curses, but they are often conflated because many people have not encountered the evil eye and don't know that it's a distinctive effect. But yeah, I mean, if you are afraid of the evil eye, you wear, you know, the Turkish blue eye amulet, you wear a kimaruta or a sprig of rue on your person. Some other spell ingredients like firewall protection oil can be used to protect against evil eye and curses, and that those are useful. But the best cure for the evil eye, and I had to do this once when I found out what the evil eye really was a beer bath, which comes from Drajan Mikaharik's book, Spiritual Cleansing, I think. And basically, you take two cans of beer, pour it into your bathtub, swirl it around, recite Psalm 23, add a little bit of salt while you do that, and then you bathe for a few minutes, and then you air dry, and then you're cured of the evil eye. But that's a sidetrack, sorry. We're not talking about curing the evil eye. We're talking about the evil eye here primarily. This is a class on curses, not, you know, on evil eye and evil. All right. There's a term to goof for someone. And the word goofy comes from it because this is a this is based on goofer dust. The term comes from a Kikongo word, which means to kill somebody. This is killing dust. In reality, it's usually not strong enough to kill someone on their own, though it probably can cause a very slow death. But what it does is once this powder is put upon a person or they walk over, they step upon it, or it's put into their food, it causes confusion, mental disorders, it makes them mumble and stumble, and that's where the word goofy comes from, because this is a method of slow death, which disrupts the body and mind and spirit quite thoroughly. It's one of the meanest things, and it's made out of snake sheds, spider sheds, sometimes rattlesnake rattles, sometimes red pepper. Let me think what other things can go in here. Scorpion stings. These are all things which represent death and poisons in the netherworld. And the idea is that if you charge this magically and it's put in contact in various ways with your target, with your enemy, it can destroy their life thoroughly. Let's see. Hexes can be any type of spell, but usually have the connotation of curses. Jinxes are a special category of curses. They're luck sinks. So jinxes, unlike crossings, are fairly temporary, but people often use jinxes at casinos. They basically absorb the luck from all the people around them, and they're the only one who wins at cards at the table. So if you use jinxing ingredients, you know, you walk around the card table and you put the powders with the oils nearby, and that absorbs all of the luck from other people, making them temporarily unlucky and brings you good fortune. There's a type of class of spells in hoodoo called putting live things in you. Usually this is done by feeding someone spider eggs in a variety of verminous materials, and the person believes that they are infested with serpents or spiders or insects crawling under their skin. Some people believe that these spells are literal and they actually do become infested by worms and so forth, but most people today now think this is a psychological thing. They get a sensation of infestation, of things crawling underneath their skin, and people who have been afflicted with live things often scratch themselves bloody and end up in the hospital because they just can't sleep, can't function because of this terrible sensation of being eaten from within. And there are also special spells which are used to undo this class of curse. It's sometimes considered a curse and sometimes considered protection, but to tie someone's tongue, it's an anti-gossip type spell, binding someone so that they are unable to speak against you. It's also sometimes used to prevent someone from doing incantatory curses against you because you're binding the organ which issues that power as well. And there are also spells which are used to wither someone away to nothing, prevent them from eat, and to cause them accelerated aging, both in voodoo and lots of other traditions as well. There's a concept in voodoo that you fix an item. You basically take a non-magical object and use herbs or oils or other materials that you touch that with it, and it becomes resonant with the power of that. So that if I had Jinx oil here and I put that on, let's see, a granola bar, and that would mean I'd be fixing the granola bar. I would give it to my enemy, they would eat it, and they would become Jinx by consuming the power that's been transferred through the oil upon the granola bar and into their body. And there's also the idea of a trick. A trick is a type of spell which is done secretly because you're either manipulating someone or you're doing damage to them metaphysically. You don't want them to know because you don't want them to have an adequate defense. There are different schools of thoughts with regards to secrecy and curses beyond what I've said before. There is the popular notion, mostly from Haitian voodoo, that if you tell somebody they're cursed, that curse would be made more effective. I don't find this to be the truth at all. I feel that this is mostly a psychological operation rather than a way of enhancing the destructive potential of the spell. My feeling is that spells should be done secretly, not only because it aggregates the power and adds force to the curse, but also it simply prevents your enemy from realizing something's wrong and taking countermeasures. There's also a notion of turning the tables, or turning a trick in hoodoo, where basically a curse or a blessing is turned backwards in some sense and sent back to the origination point. So, for example, if I were to make a cursed mojo bag and bury it underneath the house of an enemy, my enemy would be really smart to dig that up and then put that on my property because it would cut through my defenses enormously. Because it was spell work that I had originated from, and I'm not immune to my own attack being turned against me. You follow? Okay. The most powerful type of, rather, sorry, the most popular, not power, powerful, the most popular type of hoodoo spell that is known today are candle spells. And here are a bunch of candles. Usually, you can do use a candle spell just using an ordinary candle, even a white candle, because traditionally, candles were not colored throughout history. They were made out of tallow, usually. And only relatively recently, when synthetic dyes became more available, does the idea of colored candles even become popular. And of course, another thing that poor people would certainly do is they would take a candle and they would carve it into a form usable. So this is mostly the idea of figural candles and black candles are all independently relatively modern concepts, but they're popular, they're cool looking, and they definitely add punch to your spell. This is my favorite. This is the black skull candle. And this is what you use to perform mental influence upon your enemies. You would coat this with a hoodoo condition oil, and you would anoint it away from you. You would engrave the name of your enemy on the back and the wish that you have against them, and you would burn the candle on top of a petition paper or personal concerns or relics in order to attack an enemy. I'll get back to that material later on. These are ordinary figural candles, Adam and Eve, they often call them. This is when you want to attack a man or hurt a man or hurt a woman. I I couldn't find a black vulva candle, unfortunately, but I do have a black penis candle. And this is the type of spell that you use to bind or curse a person, a man's nature. That has two meanings in hoodoo, where you're attacking the person's virility, the man's virility, or but you're also attacking their ability to do magic, because potency, a virility, in hoodoo is associated with magical ability. So a person who is impotent or is frigid is believed to be unable to do effective magic in hoodoo. So this is more often done to destroy magical practitioners and cripple them magically, preventing them from attacking you or doing whatever they desire. It's kind of hard to see over there, but this is a candle which has two figures, a man and a woman, facing away from each other with a sort of a pillar in between. This is a divorce candle or a separation candle. It's great for breakup spells. This, of course, is a cross candle. If it's a white cross candle or a red cross candle or pink candle, that's for benevolent purposes, but this has one major function. It puts your enemy in the grave because this is a gravestone candle. Candles are beacons to the spirit world. It's a way for you to communicate in a way that spirits recognize as a kind of soul activity. A lit candle is like a person, the candle is like the spirit or the soul, and the wax is like the body. Especially in curse spells, when you're using a black candle, the idea of the black wax melting is a representation of the destruction of the body.
Say that again. The wax is the body.
And the light is the soul. Now, if you're doing long-term candle spells, the longer the candle burns, the more effective it tends to be. Though I find that realistically, you know, a small candle that burns in a few hours usually does the trick for me. But a lot of people do extended candle spells where they, right before the candle burns down, they transfer the flame to another candle, then another candle, another candle, and that's a way of extending the spell and also increasing the effectiveness of it. Before hoodoo started using candle spells, they did hurricane lamp spells. They did enchanted lamps. And the idea of that is having an eternal lamp, which has a perpetual beacon to the spiritual planes. And what you would do in this context is you would put a cursed ingredients into the base of the hurricane lamp, and you would basically replace, replenish the fluid in the candle, the oil of the lamp, I meant, every so often, and then trim the wick, and then transfer the flame to a new wick when the wick had been extinguished entirely. And this is a really good idea if you're trying to destroy someone over an extended period of time, either someone that you really want to torture slowly or someone that's putting up a great deal of resistance. You're never supposed to blow out a candle that's being used in spell work. That either nullifies the spell according to some people or basically, you know, it ages you. It takes away some of your own life. There are different traditions of this, and I don't know how true they are, but I pinch the candle that when I have to basically put it out and never blow it out. It creates some kind of connection between the life force, which is associated with your breath, and the extinction of the light of the candle. Now, another thing that's used in hoodoo are petition papers. Let's see if I can explain this. Usually, petition papers are, you take a scrap of paper and you tear it out manually. You're not supposed to use scissors for petition papers to cut out the edges. You don't want edges at all. It's usually roughly a square or a circle piece of paper, usually made from a brown shopping bag, paper bag. Once you rip it out, you basically write the name of the target or yourself. This is a curse, so it's obviously not yourself. You don't want to curse yourself. You write the name of your target in unbroken script in lines across. So let's see. Basically, you'd write an unbroken script, someone's name across, usually 13 times. I don't have the space here for that. My handwriting's terrible. And then you'd write what you wish to be done to them down 13 times like this. this is a type of binding, and also it's an expression of your intentionality. This is used in lots of different contexts in hoodoo, but in this particular one, when we're doing curses, we usually place these underneath black candles that we are burning, the lights that we are setting upon our enemies. Sometimes these are folded when they are sent, the power is being sent away from you. They are folded away from you, turned and folded away. But depending upon the size of the petition paper, that may not even be necessary underneath the candle setting that you're doing. Sometimes petition papers are dusted with curse ingredients as well, also dusted away from you. When you use paper, when you use sachet powders and herbal ingredients on hoodoo, and you're trying to impregnate that power into paper, you sprinkle it on the paper, and then you use wavy lines to draw it away from you like this. And then you can basically dust off of the paper with those ingredients, and you can reuse them for the next curse that you're doing. Go ahead. Yes?
Sorry, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Yes. Yes.
Yes, both are unbroken. The breakage suggests the failure of the spell. 13 is the number which is most closely associated with curses. There are other numerologies associated with hoodoo for benevolent purposes, but that's not what we're not covering today. All right, in order to project the power to the correct target, one way of doing that is to get personal concerns or relics of your enemy, of your victim. Personal concerns have a hierarchy in hoodoo. Some are much more intimate, and as a result, much more powerful than others. I have my own opinions about ones which work better, but here there's a list of traditional relics and personal concerns you can collect of your enemy if you can. One of the more popular ones is collecting hair, whether it's from the head, the pubic region, or the armpits. All of these are effective. These are ways of attacking a person with something very intimately connected to their body. Curses that involve hair from the head tend to involve confusion, headaches, and mental illness. And the ones that involve pubic hair tie up a person's nature and cause sexual dysfunction. Nail pairings are also popular, if you can get them. If you can find some sweaty cloth from your enemy, you can either use the cloth directly, or you can dilute it by basically washing it and squeezing, wringing the cloth into a bottle of fluids. Menstrual blood is really good. Menstrual blood is associated, of course, with things not happening because, of course, it's an indication that no one's gotten pregnant. And menstrual blood are used in lots of different ways, in lots of magical traditions to do curses as well as some types of love spells. But in this context, we're using menstrual blood and any other type of blood as well as a way of targeting your enemy specifically so the energy is more focused. Semen is also a material that you can use as a personal concern, but that's mostly used in spells to bind a person's nature. Though, of course, if that's all you can get, you can use, semen in a spell to attack a person's brain, their kidneys, any other thing. It's just that it's a little bit stronger because of the association with sexuality for that purpose. If you can get someone's vaginal secretions, that's useful. Urine is very powerful. You can use that for kidney spells, which gives people kidney stones. You can use feces to give a person endless constipation. If you can get foot scrapings, that's a good way to do foot track magic indirectly by basically combining, say, goofer dust with a person's foot scrapings as a way of goofering them remotely. Saliva is good. Tears are good. If you can find someone's crying, you steal a Kleenex from the trash. That's a really good relic. Photographs are used. That's one of the most popular ones. I find that digital photos don't work nearly as well as chemical photos, both for benevolent and malevolent uses. So I'm one of those hipster-looking guys who carries around a Fuji or a Polaroid one-step type camera because I can use those as relics for positive or negative purposes later on much more effectively than digital stuff I printed off online. Captured breath. Okay, this is a wonderfully dirty trick. I don't think a lot of people know this. If you find someone that you want to do a spell upon who's sleeping, you take a little baby food jar with a cap, and when they exhale, you capture the breath in the jar, and you seal it shut quickly, and then you put it in your pocket. That is a really powerful personal concern. Captured voice is another technique that's useful, but it kind of requires some low tech, some old tech, I mean. You take a mini cassette recorder and you record a person's outgoing voicemail message or any recording of their voice, and that cassette can be a personal concern that you can put on the altar, which forges a connection to that person's speech. If you want to make a person be unable to say things, to do a scoff gossip, a little mini cassette is a really great way of using that as a personal concern to attack a person's ability to do spell work upon you that's verbal, as well as to speak ill of you. Signatures are sometimes used. Business cards are sometimes used. These are considered to be low order personal concerns. They're not as effective, but you can use them in a pinch if you want to. Lifted footprints, if you can somehow find a person, your enemy, walking across soil, or you can get them to walk across a path where you've scattered dirt, you can scoop up that dirt, you can scoop up where their foot has been made some kind of impression, put it in a little Ziploc bag and do curses upon that material, and it will attack the person from beneath. Yes?
Snow.
When you step on a stone, you're not going to be able to leave
snow.
An impression.
Snow.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Sorry, I misheard you there. You can use snow. It, of course, will melt. That might probably be really good for freezer spells. If I took the snow and put it in a Ziploc bag and it melted it, then I put some curse ingredients and I froze it up, that person would become immobile. That's clever. Another type of spell, and this goes beyond Hoodoo, there's even versions of this going back 1,000 years ago into Pecatrix, which involve a person's measure. If you take a measurement of a person from their head to their heel, that's one version of the measure. Another version of the measure is from the tip of the penis to the anus in men, and in women from the vaginal opening to the anus. This measurement can be cut upon a cord, and the things done to the cord are done to the person from which the measurement is taken. You can bind the cord with knots as a way of tying a person up. You can whip the cord and cause them to experience pain. If you take the genital measures and you basically, you tie them in knots and put them into a freezer, that will lock up their nature and prevent them from having sex and doing spell work. Those are really great things to do if you can get the exact measurement. Now, one of the strategies that I use is, well, firstly, I dress in black a lot, so I always carry a lint roller wherever I go. But I've got another agenda with my lint roller. I use it to collect personal concerns wherever I go. So, you know, if I see someone say, oh, there's a little bit of lint on your back, I'm just taking a little bit of your hair. No, no problem here. Take off the lint, put it in my pocket, and carry it later. And I have a file cabinet full of hairs that I've taken off of people over the years, just in case things go wrong with them. All labeled and dated.
That's great.
Very dexter of you.
Yeah. Another thing I do is, usually when you go to a hotel or in many homes, the bed sheets are white. That's really good for picking up red hair or black hair off of the pillow. When I go into the bathroom of people that I don't necessarily have a good relationship with, I look for combs that are filled with hair, and I basically use a fine-tooth comb to harvest that. And sometimes when I'm in a hurry, I actually steal the comb, and hopefully they don't realize it, but I've done that a few times where I've stolen the used comb in someone's home, and I've used that on my curse altars to manipulate them or to do them harm. I, of course, do all of this very ethically. Yes?
You mentioned a lot of bodily fluids. What else
did that? There's no reason why that couldn't work. That's not as traditional. It's never been mentioned in the books or any practitioners that I've used. But if you're fishing Kleenexes for tears out of the trash, I'm sure there's going to be some snot in there as well. And that would probably be very, very good for attacking a person in the head. This appears in the lore, and I don't know how many people would get away with this, but if you find bed sheets which have sexual fluids or blood, you can cut them out and use that as a basis of your personal concern. If you can steal someone's dirty laundry, which might have sexual fluids, sweat, or blood in them, that's also really good for a personal concern. I don't know why you would want to curse somebody you just had sex with, but maybe you can arrange this by other means. But if you can find a used condom or a dental dam, these can be used as powerful personal concerns, not only for binding the nature, but also just very good at dominating the person that was associated with those fluids. If you can find sex toys which have not been properly washed, you can wipe them down as well and use those secretions that are on that remain upon them as personal concerns. Another thing you can do is that people are a little bit vain, and if you ask them for photos, they sometimes give it to you. You know, they can only say no, and people are kind of vain. So if you ask for a signature, if you ask for a memento, if you ask for a photo, people will often give it to you and not realize that you might potentially be able to do spell work upon them. Recently, I did a spell involving I Can, You Can't products, and it created a circumstance where photographs of people that I was not getting along with fell into my hands almost by accident. And now I have leverage over them as a result. Let's see. You can trick people into, yes?
Sorry, you might have already done this before, but just for my reference. Is the information mostly
movies,
or is it just in general?
Wait, I didn't hear the first part.
I thought you may have already said this before, so I apologize. But is the information you're giving mostly hoodoo based?
This section is mostly hoodoo. The reason why I tend to focus a little bit on hoodoo on the front end, though I don't use it exclusively, is that it's inexpensive, it's simple, it's really beautiful, it's a powerful tradition, and there's an abundance of curse techniques in hoodoo. Other forms of magic may have lots of curses, but they're not nearly as elaborate or as accessible as hoodoo curses. Let's see. And ways you can lift footprints is you can, like I said before, you can scatter dirt where a person's going to be walking, you can scoop up later. If you can bring a person to you where they have to walk across soil or mud, this is a way of being able to gain the use of their feet by surreptitious means. Yeah, that's good. All right, curse symbologies. Red and black materials are often used in curse materials and curse spells of many different traditions. Black represents darkness and death, and red represents blood and fire. Sometimes these are associated in planetary magic with the greater malefic Saturn and the lesser malefic Mars, Saturn being associated with darkness and decay, and Mars associated with fire and blood. When I try to do my spell work, my curse work, I tend to keep the symbologies consistent. So if I'm using hot spells, I tend to lean more towards red pepper, blood, red things. And if I'm doing decay magic, it tends to be black and consistent with Saturnine symbology. When you mix these up, it's not always a positive mix. I did that somewhat recently, a curse which did not go well, where I combined Saturnine and Martian symbology in the working, a little bit complex to explain. And those things don't get along together, because that's one of the other things about the planets. They have personalities, and Mars and Saturn are enemies of each other. So if you want to get, you use the power of the planets in your magical work, whether it's hoodoo or otherwise, try not to mix Saturnine and Martial fueled spells. One of the common things we see in almost all black magic is a favoritism towards the left hand and the left side of things. This is often thought of as negative, dangerous, and deadly. And so if you're engraving things on a black candle, it's often best to do it with your left hand. If you're projecting curse power, you do it from the left side of the body. Let's see. One of the metaphors that you see in many different magical traditions is the metaphor of poisons. Back in ancient times, they really couldn't tell the difference between spellcraft and an actual poisons, because they were all mysterious and involved knowledge beyond conventional teachings. But today we know that powdered scorpion stings are not actually going to kill someone unless you charge it magically, and that's a magical effect rather than a chemical effect. But the metaphor of poisons is extended not only through hoodoo, the hoodoo is very embraces that thoroughly, but also appears in practically every curse tradition and every magical system. When you are doing curse work involving writing in hoodoo, sometimes spells require you to write things backwards. Things which are being done counterclockwise or backwards are associated with harm and undoing things and unmaking things. There are lots of spells in hoodoo involving broken mirrors. Broken mirrors often cause a person to reflect upon their misdeeds and be filled with anguish and sorrow and confusion. So you often see spells involving mirror boxes where broken mirrors are placed on the interior of a shoebox or a miniature coffin where you put a poppet inside. And that's not a way of both reflecting a person's curses back upon them, but also causing them anguish and sorrow and despair. And I just added here kind of randomly that frankincense and hoodoo increase the power of every operation, even negative ones. So if you add a little frankincense powder or burn some frankincense resin, it will enhance the power of your curses and make them more destructive. There are patterns which appear in hoodoo materials which express why these things are associated with curses, a core poetry, a symbology, or a series of metaphors. And I like going through these because they create the pattern and the flow of the symbology in magical systems. So there are materials which have pungent and foul odors, like asafoetida, valerian root, and skunk cabbage, and these are used for curses in hoodoo. There are materials which are pesticides, like boric acid, mothballs and crystals, flypaper, and rat poison. These are used in spells and hoodoo curses upon people, because it projects that ability to destroy vermin, because you see your enemies as vermin. There are elements from poisonous creatures, things which kill through contact and through venom and poison. Snake sheds, where snakes are sometimes venomous. Tarantula sheds, snake heads, spider eggs, and snake eggs are all used to take that poisonous quality of these animals, the deadly quality of these animals, and project them into your enemy. Poisonous herbs are sometimes used, like dogbane, though of course you guys should be handling these with gloves. And these are not the sorts of things that you'd want to actually put on or in your target, because that actually is poisoning and potentially murder. You will go to jail. But sprinkling a little bit of a poisonous herb on your black candle, that's perfectly acceptable, and that's a way of projecting that power metaphysically into your enemy. There are herbs which are unpleasantly spicy, like red pepper, black pepper, chicory, grains of paradise, and black mustard seeds. The discomfort that you get by eating too much pepper, for example, is projected into your enemy, causes agitation, discomfort, and despair. There are things which are associated with death, like graveyard dirt, coffin nails, gopher dust, Spanish moss, tobacco, which provides spirit contact with the dead. These are things you do to channel the spirits of the graveyard to bring your enemies closer to the grave. There are things which are black in color, like the eggs from a black hen, which are used in curses quite a bit. Black mustard seeds, black poppy seeds, and walnut leaves, which are all dark in color. There are herbs and materials which are associated with biblical evils, like Jezebel root to cause the downfall of a temptress, and sulfur, which is associated, of course, with hell. There are things which are associated with sorrow, like blueberry leaves. The only reason why blueberry leaves are used in hoodoo for sorrow is because you say that you're blue and you're sad. Painful things are used in hoodoo, like cactus spines, nails, pins, shards of glass and mirrors, stinging and biting insect carcasses, dirt dauber nests, salt, and Epsom salts. Entangling things are used, like couch grass, also known as witch grass. Things which are associated with violence, like gunpowder and saltpeter, which is an ingredient in gunpowder. Black dog hair mixed with black cat hair to cause fighting, like between cats and dogs. Things which are associated with stupors and altered states of consciousness, like poppy seeds. Sour things, like vinegar, including Four Thieves vinegar. Lemon is often used in curses spells to cause breakups, and lemon verbena is also used. And decayed things, sour milk is often used to project decay and ruin upon an enemy. Also stale bread, moldy bread, and rotting organ meats. If you can take small portions of that and mix that into a larger confection that you can feed into your enemy, it's a way of poisoning them from within. Even if they don't actually get sick from the food, they may get sick from the energy you're pouring into it. Okay. Next phase, astrological magic. All right. There's no way for me to really... Oh, go ahead.
I was wondering if there was any particular reasons for, like, financial
work. Oh, yes. I love this. Okay.
Like I gotta take a drink.
There was somebody years and years ago pissed me off. And it was actually, I was doing a tarot reading and asked, okay, what should I do about this? And it gave me the Ten of Swords. Well, what do you mean? Cliff, basically, tarot told me, you need to do a poverty curse against this guy. Tarot usually tells me the right thing to do. And through a process of elimination, I got a very elaborate spell instruction on what I was supposed to do to this poor guy. And yes, it worked pretty well. So what I did was I took a green candle, which is usually associated with prosperity, and I took a candle like this, a little black candle, and I dribbled some black wax to corrupt the candle in the top. And I think I anointed the candle, I dressed the candle with inflammatory confusion oil and destruction oil in combination. And I probably sprinkled one of the powders on the top. It could have been goofer dust, sulfur, I'm not sure, it was a long time ago. But the really interesting part of the spell was that I took a mirror that I got from a dollar store, and I took the reflection of the guy's photo, because I had the guy's photo, and I made it so that the mirror would see his picture. And while it was doing that, I took inflammatory confusion oil and I obscured the image with the mirror. Then I put the mirror face down upon the photograph of the guy, and I took the base of the green candle and I smashed the mirror and ground it into the photograph. And then I lit the candle on top of that mess, my destruction altar. And about a week later, the guy lost his job. They turned off the power of his apartment. He was using the last minutes of his internet access to post on his blog that his life was failure, his girlfriend had left him, everything was wrong, and he was on the verge of suicide. So that worked pretty well. That was fun. That makes me feel a little bit guilty, but all right. Poverty spells are fun. You know, finding the weakest link is a really great target. If you know somebody's vulnerable in a particular way, don't hold back, just destroy them. Poverty curses are really useful in that a person who is having financial problems is too busy to react to anything going on in your life. If they're causing you problems in your love life, they're doing spell work against you, if they're harassing you, if suddenly they're penniless, they're just really busy all the time trying to get money. They will leave you the fuck alone. All right. Now, I described cursed talismans a little bit earlier. Basically, you can take practically any planetary talisman and make it wrong, so that will bring misfortune to someone. But there are also particular stellar bodies, stellar objects like fixed stars, lunar mansions, and decans, which also have cursed properties. Well, let me start off with petitions, because it comes, it's here. Petitions are basically elected wishes and conjurations of planetary and celestial spirits. This is mostly what I do for a living. If one of my clients wants me to curse somebody, I will do a Mars petition. And a Mars petition basically will involve me timing it so that the ruler of the ascendant, and this is astrology tech talk, so if you don't understand it, it's okay. I make sure that the ruler of the ascendant is making a fortunate aspect to Mars, whatever planetary hierarchy that I'm trying to petition, and then I dress up in martial garments. I dress in red. I have a sword around my neck, a little pendant shaped like a sword. I hold guns in both of my hands. I play martial music, you know, Marsbringer, Wolf of Wolf's Planet Suite. And then I have suffumigation, which is made up of like 16 ingredients. It's hard to make. And I burn that, and I make a prayer to Mars from an incantational text in Bacatrix, and ask Mars to strike down my client's enemies. The idea of genies granting wishes probably comes from this type of ritual in Bacatrix. And you can use Mars to cause violence and lawsuits upon enemies. You can cause Mars to, you can call down Saturn to cause premature aging in your targets. You can cause the star Alcade to engage in a variety of deadly vengeance upon your enemies, but you can also use the other planets in different ways. Now, the planetary petitions are a little bit inaccessible. I'm probably the only person who's been doing them in the traditional way for the past few hundred years. Much more accessible are deliberately created malevolent talismans which are encase a malformed spirit or planet or star, so they radiate negativity, death, and dismay in their environment. Now, in order to create an astrological talisman, you have to be first proficient in astrology, which most of you are probably not. But the electional astrology involved, it goes well beyond planetary hours and days. This is a branch of what we call electional astrology, the choosing of fortunate times. But in curse work, you're choosing unfortunate times. So that normally, if you wanted to create a benevolent talisman, Venus would be essentially dignified in Taurus, Pisces, and Libra. In order to create a malevolent Venus talisman, you'd want Venus in the signs opposite to those, which incidentally happen to be the signs of Mars, because Mars and Venus are oppositional in nature. So you would create a malevolent Venus talisman while Venus was transiting Aries or transiting Scorpio or, let's see, what's the opposite of Capricorn? Well, anyway, those are good ones for Venus. Virgo. Virgo is a really good place to put Venus to make her afflicted. And then you engrave the sigils of Venus during the planetary hours, trapping the spirits of that hierarchy for that purpose. Curse talismans are not worn. They are planted in the proximity of your enemy, their home. Yeah?
I was just wondering, you know, talking about striking down gravities and all that. Can you just do like a general one, like a general, like, all my enemies be struck down, you know, like either through the hoodoo or the planetary or astrology?
Yes, but it's generally not considered as strong. What you can do is that you're parading a curse and you don't know who your enemy is. You can, instead of putting their name, you can write my enemy. And that will attack that particular person. However, it's not clear whether you have to create a new spell for each enemy that crops up. If you don't know your enemy, you can certainly put a generalized petition where you write my enemy into the petition paper or in your conjuration. So if I were doing a petition to Mars to curse my enemy, I may not know who my enemy is. Mars will figure it out. Mars knows how to track people down. Yes?
Maybe a stupid question.
Yeah, sure.
Is it possible to use these same things not only to curse, but as protection as well? As like because when she was asking if you could use it on like a broader spectrum of enemies, mm-hmm. instead of doing that, could you use it as almost like a protection, as if someone were to cross the boundary, it would be like immediate backfire?
You can do things like that. You can do things like that, but there's usually a distinction between protection and attacks. But there are some protective methods which are aggressive in their force. So. Yeah, so I mean, you can use aggressive wards. I use fiery wall of protection oil on my person every day, and the idea that this is fiery is that, really? Okay. The idea is that when a person transgresses against you or attacks you, they get burned by the spell. Oh, we have so little time. Okay. Other important things we need to discuss. Before you do your curses and after you do your curses, you need to do a hyssop bath. This is purification, prevents the negativity from clinging to you. Often this is associated with various prayers and psalms. Psalm 23 is very useful for this. But you can make this more powerful afterwards by adding rue salt, bath salts, which is Epsom salts, saltpeter, agrimony, lemongrass, mint, and others. You take the ring, yes?
Would there be a resource where we can go look at stuff?
Yes, I'll try to put that online. All right. If you need to clean up your space, you use Chinese wash or use Van Van oil in a bucket of water to clean up the space so the negative energy doesn't cling to you. If you're using this within your house, if you're doing this within your curse altar rather than a separated space. As I said before, the different sources of power have different limitations. The natural world is the least powerful and most accessible. The celestial world is highly powerful and reliable, but very complex to access. The divine world is most powerful, mostly easy to access, but is unreliable because the gods choose who they will at their own discretion. And the infernal world is powerful, moderately hard to access, complex, but usually requires a heavy price paid. If you conjure demons, bad things may happen to you. You use Saturn for sickness curses. Use Mars for violence curses, Sun for domination, Mercury for confusion, and Moon for forgetfulness spells. And, all right, since we have so little time, and I have so much more material, to ask me more questions. This is probably a good time for that.
In a former workshop elsewhere, the person leading the workshop was a hoodoo practitioner and talked a lot about root magic.
Yes.
And can you elaborate on that just a little bit? I just need a refresher on that.
Well, root work is often used as a term in alternation with hoodoo or conjure and various other things. One thing you can do is you can cast roots upon someone. You can take a powder and throw it upon a person while they're not looking, and it's a way of projecting power through the material as well as literally casting the spell upon a person. These are powders which contain such roots. Here's crossing powder, confusion powder, that's self-explanatory, doom, death unto my enemies. This is a killing powder. Here's bat's blood powder. This is a way of enhancing the strength of a curse. I find this to be extremely effective. This is breakup powder. You do this to cause people to break up with their lover. You might put a little powder like this, and you know, if they're not wearing black, you can sort of touch them on the back of their clothes, and they'll cause them to fight with their lover. This is Spanish moss. This is something you could throw upon someone as they walk away. That's another way of throwing roots. This is most frequently used inside poppet spells, which we didn't get a chance to cover. You stuff up a poppet with Spanish moss, maybe you put a little bit of moth crystals or sulfur or various other things, and then you basically torment the poppet after it's been baptized in the name of your enemy, and that negativity is projected through the effigy towards them. Effigies go back to even ancient Egypt. Those are very effective spells, using something formed and named in the kinship of your enemy as a way of projecting power through the object as an intermediary. Let's see. I told you about the goofer dust. There's jinx powder here. Let's see. Here's another thing that's really fun. Hot foot spells. Hot foot spells, I wanted to bring the powder. That's the more traditional form. You basically, you cross the earth with it. You basically make a winding line and then cross it with the powder, and then you spit on it in order to activate it. And anybody who walks over that, if it's crossing powder, it brings them durable bad luck. But if it's if it's a hot foot spell, it causes them to wander the earth without rest. It causes them to be homeless. It causes them to be restless. And it causes them great agitation in mind and suffering. That's a very traditional hoodoo spell. Any other ones that are interesting here? Black arts oil. This is often used not just for curses, though it is used for curses, but also conjure dark spirits to you can enlist for your aid. It contains black dog hair and sulfur and a bunch of other nasty things. Yes?
Can you buy these oils somewhere or do you make them?
Yeah, these are all Lucky Mojo products. They're the person who runs Lucky Mojo is an old friend of mine, Kat Ironwood. But a lot of these things you can make. There are lots of traditional formulas which appear online. And there are, of course, lots of other hoodoo shops other than Lucky Mojo, which are great as well and definitely worthy of your development.
Are they more potent
if
you make them yourself?
All things being equal, yes, they are more potent if you make them yourself, but I find that you have to be good at making these products. So for example, I suck at making magical oils. There's only one magical oil that I've ever made that actually was worth a damn, and it's really good, but it's only one. So I mostly delegate that kind of thing off to things that I buy off the shelf. But all things being equal, when you put yourself into the magic, when you create the things, it imparts some of your power into it and some of your essence and some of your energies. Yes?
How do the retrogrades affect those planets?
When it comes to the astrological elements, such as astrological influences, retrogradations of Mercury, for example, are very good for confusion and breakdowns of electronics. Retrogradations of Venus are good for causing love affairs to break down and to cause people to go back to old lovers. The planet which goes retrograde it embodies things which are going back to a prior state, but much more importantly, going into a state of disorder and disobedience for your particular intentions. So Jupiter being retrograde, Jupiter is normally associated with bringing in wealth. Jupiter retrograde is associated with loss of money. Saturn retrograde is basically your ill fortunes turning back upon yourself. The moon doesn't go retrograde, and the sun doesn't go retrograde. That's where the luminaries. But the other planets, when they exhibit retrogradation, or they exist in another state of affliction, like being an inimical sign in a state of essential debility, they express themselves in the inhospitable way to all people here on Earth. Though they will express themselves to varying degrees of malevolence based upon a person's natal chart. Some people, for example, believe that if they have a retrograde planet on their natal chart, they thrive in that environment. I'm not sure if that's true or not. Certainly people who have planets which are said to be afflicted in the natal chart are affected when the planet is in a hospitable state in ongoing transits. Next.
Good question. What is the best spell to manipulate someone?
Okay, the best spell to manipulate someone that I know are skull spells. They don't necessarily need to be a black skull. I sometimes use green skulls to manipulate people for money. I use white skulls to bless a person and relieve them of mental illness and distress. Usually put influence oil on the colored candle and the color of the candle, as well as your petition, either written on the back of the skull or in a petition paper underneath it, expresses your wish to come true. But you can get spicier, so you can take a black skull spell and use essence of bend over oil, which dominates a person and subjugates them. Domination oil is another way of doing that. Let me see. There's a variety of oil formulas, like controlling oil and compelling oil, which allow you to take control of a person for particular goals. So compelling oils is used to specifically force people to honor promises they made to you.
But when you put a piece of paper underneath a burning candle, doesn't that paper, when the candle burns down, doesn't that paper catch?
Well, it would if you didn't put a tray or a saucer underneath
okay,
it. Right, so I should have mentioned that just for fire safety. If you're putting your petition paper underneath your candle, there should be something in between which prevents the paper from catching fire. I usually use a saucer, usually a black one, for curses.
How do you dispose of your remnants and the paper?
I almost got to that. Okay. When you're done with the spell, you either plant the remainders of the candle or the spell that you're working on the property of your enemy at a crossroads if you want it to be dispersed, or in a graveyard, in a grave, whether it's a consecrated graveyard or an unconsecrated graveyard, depends upon the type of spell. But what you do with this stuff does matter. Sometimes, just for convenience sake, you just throw it away. I do that a little bit too often, but that's not the ideal. The ideal is that you take the remnants of your spell and you use that as a part of the spell to express how you are sending that energy towards your enemy.
What are your thoughts on using various plants for spell work like that? Because they're living plants, so would that make it more finicky, like coniferous plants or strangling vines, stuff like that?
There are particular hoodoo spells which involve planting things in trees, like writing the name of your enemy on an egg and then putting in a bird's nest up in a tree as a way of causing them to dry out, like the contents of the egg dries out and causes them to wither. There are special spells which involve particular types of trees, so that you find a sweet gum tree and you drill a hole in it because it's got a very fragrant sap, and you put the personal concerns of your enemy into the tree, and as the tree grows, your enemy suffers and dies. Go ahead.
Is there a good compendium that you can recommend of the different magical ingredients and recipes for these different oils and powders?
Yes, but I'm forgetting its name. It's a book by Kat Ironwood called The Hoodoo Herb and Magic.
Hoodoo Herb and Root Magic.
Hoodoo
Herb and Root Magic.
Hoodoo Herb and Root Magic. I always forget, I just call it the green book, I'm sorry, but it's a wonderful reference. I've got like 5 copies, all yellow highlighter and page tabs. It's fantastic. Hoodoo, Root, and Herb Encyclopedia, what was it?
That's Hoodoo, Herb, and Root Magic.
Hoodoo, Herb, and Root Magic.
The green book.
The green book. I'm sorry about that.
Yeah.
All right. I hope you've enjoyed yourself. Curses should not only be deadly, they should be fun.